Thank you all for being here. My name is Tim, and
my name is Giel,
and we are third year bachelor degree students, and we are here to tell you guys about our experience doing our first fieldwork in Tanzania. Past year, we were really privileged because we were able to be part of the research traineeship program. At which we were able to work on the Iraku Text and Society project, which is a project geared towards the production and dissemination of linguistic resources, and in this case, Iraku linguistic resources among the Iraku community. And before we start our journey, Giel will inform us a little bit about the exact area where we were last summer. So Giel, take it away. Yeah, go stand somewhere where everybody can see us because we are joined to this. So I'm gonna walk slowly to this side or this side. Okay, working with the technology here. Okay, Giel, take it away.
Well, this is a beautiful map from Google Maps. As you can see, this is a map of Tanzania, and this is the black square, which is here. So we went to this place right here, which is called Kwermul. It's a small village in Tanzania near Mbulu. We stayed here for 6 weeks, I think.
Yeah, and it's the village is so small that Google Maps does not even know that it exists. So yeah, we were obliged to put a little dot there to show where exactly the village is. Next slide. The objectives. We had a couple of objectives. The two of us had two main objectives. I had one and Giel had the other. My main objective was making an online spelling course, and the online spelling course consists actually of YouTube videos which are accessible to everyone with a very low level of difficulty. So maybe Giel wants to tell a little bit about
that. And my project was making a simplified grammar of the Iraku language, which basically means writing the existing linguistic grammar by Maarten in such a way that the linguistics concepts are also clear for the community, so they can use it to get to know a little bit more about their own language. And we also had a couple of personal objectives, which was first of all gaining fieldwork experience, for me was very valuable to actually go somewhere and do something.
Fieldwork for the first time. Nice experience.
And also finding our way around Tanzania.
Yeah, I believe there are people in this room who are more experienced on traveling through Tanzania maybe. But for us it was the first time, so it was a great opportunity to figure out how the country actually works, and also speaking a little bit of Swahili on the side. A little bit of background information on the Iraku people. I believe that some of you, or maybe almost everybody, knows maybe a bit or a lot about it. But the Iraku, the language, is spoken by approximately 500,000 people. It's part of the South Cushitic language family, as you can see there. It's actually, with regards to the amount of speakers, it's the largest language of that particular linguistic branch, I believe, because the other languages are spoken by far less people. And on the right side, you see our host, Ephraim, and he is sitting beside the grave of one of his ancestors, and he is telling him about upcoming festivities. So it's a tradition there to inform all your ancestors about festivities that are going on in the in that village. Yeah, the purpose of the grammar and the spelling course, why were we actually there, or why would it be necessary to make spelling course or grammar for that matter, or simplified grammar. There are a couple of reasons, a couple of purposes we had, namely to make linguistic resources accessible to the local community and also to everyone who is interested. Also to encourage people of the local community to join the Iraku Text and Society project, because by making their language more accessible, it might be more easy and people might even get encouraged to join our calls. As a third, also to make it able for the local community to gain some knowledge on their own language with regards to the spelling course I'm still working on. Via that spelling course, they are able to gain valuable information regarding the spelling of their own language and how to write their own language. So those are some of the purposes of the projects. Yeah, the methodology. While we were there, we had the availability of one informant. In some instances, that might lead to some restrictions on the linguistic fieldwork you are able to do. But in our case, it wasn't that much of a problem, because our objectives were pretty practical. So. And it was a nice lady who was really well educated, so she spoke three languages, which was easy for us. So we could speak in English, and we weren't obliged to try to find our way around in Swahili, which I would have loved. But we were also able to speak English there. While I worked with this nice lady, most of my work consisted of word elicitation and making the Swahili translations of the English version of the course I made, because I made two versions, one in Swahili and one in English. And I started making the English version because I am more proficient in English. And by making the English course first, I translated actually the English course into Swahili with the help of our informant, Basilisa. And she also provided her voice for the linguistic course. So we recorded all the Iraku words and all the Iraku dialogue, and she provided me with that valuable insight and information and knowledge. And a simplified grammar he worked on.
Yeah. How I did it was just trying to provide an explanation of the linguistic concepts relevant to the Iraku language, and then check whether it's understandable, and then make changes. And also by discussing many examples in the Iraku language. And currently it's only available in English, so one next step in the project could be that we could also translate this into Swahili, so it'd be accessible to more community members than just the English-speaking ones.
Yeah.
So
even more accessible. I also wanted to show or lift the veil surrounding the content of the spelling course. I don't go into that much depth. I see that something went wrong with the way it is presented here, but that's okay. The total course consists of actually five lessons. I see that there are only four on this one, but the fifth I will inform you about. And this is also the order in which the lesson will take place. So I provided workings on vowel length. You start with vowel length in lesson one, and then the tone on vowels, and then the consonants, and then some rounded versions of consonants, the glottal stop, the stroke is referring to the nice sound, which is written via that sign, And almost the last lesson is about the differentiation between the hung and the hung, which is also written in a different way. And lesson five, which isn't on this slide, is actually practice on writing sentences. So making it available for the Iroko people to also learn how to write full sentences. So this looks like a lot, and it is, because I'm still working on it, and editing all the material took more time than I thought. Actually making one lesson takes about 3 hours, and I'm also making corresponding exercises with each lesson, so I hopefully am ready at the end of this year with everything, because I'm still working on it every day. And also, not unimportant, some subscribe to our YouTube channel. We have a very nice YouTube channel, Iroko Research Materials. There aren't that much materials on there yet, but I am planning on uploading one video today. So if you want to be the first one to see what that video is all about, look it up on YouTube, Iroko Research Materials. All right. Some of the pitfalls. All right. Giel, step in if you would feel like it. Starting with the spelling course, maybe a lot of you recognize some of our problems, because when you are in the field and you are in a small village, not much is available to you. So it might be difficult when your software or the materials you bring with you do not work. That's quite a big pitfall. But luckily for me, I was able to do a lot of my work while I was here, while I returned, and also having a reliable energy source became somewhat of an obstacle to us, because we had solar panels. Maybe some of you recognize this problem, but when there isn't that much sun for a couple of days, you don't have that much energy either. So there were days and a couple, maybe 3 or 4 days, where Giel and I weren't able to do any work because the sun didn't shine. So that were some of my pitfalls, and Giel will tell you about the simplified grammar pitfalls.
I tried to base the simplified grammar on the grammar made by Maarten Maus, but there, obviously the language has changed since the grammar came out. So I had a couple of times where I tried to explain some things, but then it wasn't really relevant in the language anymore, or the use of it had changed quite a bit. So that was quite a challenge, but I think I managed to work it all out. And as I already mentioned, it's not yet available in Swahili, so that would be a next step in the project. And I also have the issue of the
having a reliable energy source.
Lack of energy energy source sometimes. So
And did I tell you guys to subscribe to our YouTube channel, Iroko Research Materials? Write it down in your notebooks. Iroko Research Materials. Thank you very much. The conclusion with regards to future projects.
First thing I said already two times. Translating the grammar into Swahili could be one of the next steps. And also what I currently did is I in the simplified grammar I only took the phonology and the noun phrase. So that's what I did until now. So I'm planning on going back sometime, so then I could finish the rest, which would be the verb phrase. So that could also be the next step.
Yeah, and with regards to the spelling course, it would be nice in the future to have a more complex spelling course, because the course I am working on still and planning to make consists mostly of dictation practice. So when you take part in the course, you hear a lot of the words, and then after you hear them, you have to write them down and see if they are correct. But hopefully in the future, maybe I will be a part of this project, or maybe somebody else is able to make a more complex spelling course, which will go in more depth into some of the phonological processes and maybe even more complex sentences and good stuff like that. And to round it all off, Giel and I both don't know how often we have to thank our lovely professor Maarten Maus. So thank you, Maarten. Because this is the man who made this all available. Thank you, Maarten. We would love to thank you four times, as it appears. So thank you very much. And to the end, afak means the end in Iraku. So afak. Thank you very much.
So I believe we have time for one or two questions. If anyone has questions or comments for Tim and Peel.
Will you go back?
Maybe Labda.
Labda.
Labda Badai. Maybe later.
One day.
Do Iraku speakers, do they know how to spell? Do they have, if they haven't taken your lovely course, do they have some kind of idea how to write Iraku?
Well, there are people in this room who are more knowledgeable on that, but my experience being there is that there are a lot of people who know bits and pieces, so people have a grasp, some kind of grasp how to write it. But subjects like vowel length and tone are also very difficult for a speaker. So that's why I also started the course with those subjects. So there is some knowledge. I believe it isn't taught on schools, Iraku, only Swahili and English. There is a need for this course because it isn't made or provided by any educational system. So. But there is some knowledge, I believe. And the people I tested this on had some knowledge and found my course really accessible. So that was a nice feedback moment for me. But there is some knowledge, but not much, because it isn't... you don't need it that much, because it's Swahili and English. So most of the people have only, how would you say it? Not that much profound knowledge on how to write. And maybe Maarten can assess that notion, but that was my experience being there. So, any more questions? That's why. No.
Just building on that. So, in what context would people be writing in Iraku? So, Maarten might have a better idea, but would people text each other in Iraku? Or do you think they typically use Swahili?
That would be a really nice, that would be really nice. In the same line of thought as your question, Giel and I are also managing the YouTube channel, and on there we see that there are a small group of people, we are not sure how big that group is, who are really happy and relieved that there is some resources on their own language. So I believe there is a group of people who are dying to use their own language in a written form. So there is this emotional a grounding for that. And social media would be awesome. It would be awesome if we could start a revolution.
They use it a little bit in the Facebook group that I'm not a member of, because I'm not Iraq, I was not allowed. And they in the texting, what I've seen, they usually use Swahili, but then for Happy New Year, things like that, they would want to do that in Iraq. And you see names of all sorts in the linguistic landscape written in Iraq in different spelling conventions.
That's why my course is needed.
All right, well, thank you again.
Yeah, thank you very much.